equitable share by the 15th day of the month, with money credited to the central bank account for the collective county revenue fund account specifically. Now, right now, we just want to interrogate some of these issues that are bedeviling the counties. Joining us via way of Zoom, Speaker of the Senate, Ken Lusaka. A very good morning to you, and thank you for your time. I know you did serve as a governor during the onset of devolution. Let's start from that particular point. Was the case similar during the initial 5 years of devolution?
Yeah, thank you very much. It is always a pleasure to talk to Kenyans about matters that affect their lives. Yeah, you are right. I served as a governor from 2013 to 2017. We had a bit of challenges in terms of the timelines of receiving the revenues in the counties. But I think the situation has been worsened this time. Looking at the delays that are being witnessed this time, I think it's more, and we need to do something, otherwise the counties are going to have a lot of problems. We had a lot of challenges, but thank God we had what we call the transition authority that really facilitated the counties to take off. And although we had delays, but the delays were not as bad as we are witnessing today.
Well noted. Even as we speak about doing something, let's talk about solutions. We've seen the Council of Governors, which, by the way, right now the chair is synonymous with asking the Treasury to release funds. We've seen the press conference approach. We've definitely seen them go to court earlier on during this journey in devolution. What do you think is actually ailing this whole process? Is it simply goodwill or lack of it in the National Treasury?
I think there's goodwill. I think the problem would be challenges in terms of revenue collection. Even as late as yesterday, the Committee of Finance had summoned the Minister of Finance to explain the delay, that there seem to be challenges in terms of raising enough money to disburse to the counties. But what I was going to suggest, and I have said this before, one, and I'm happy that the Commission on Revenue Allocation has embarked on it, is what we call on-source revenue strategy, where counties are encouraged to collect their own sources so that they don't rely on the shareable revenue that is coming from the national government. And again, I was listening in, and I want also to agree that I think we need to get a strategy where county governments are allowed to spend at source some funds so that they are not stuck. Because these are the business of, you know, having to rely on the national government, having to rely on treasury, having to rely on the control of budget, you know, approving a lot of these things. This is causing unnecessary delays, and counties are really suffering. I know contractors have not been paid. Some contractors have even committed suicide. Some have died because of stress. Therefore, I still want to insist that we encourage on-source revenue, and we also encourage maybe spending at the source so long as it's properly monitored and coordinated. And, you know, on-source revenue, I gave an example about 2 weeks ago when we had a meeting with the CRA, who are launching this on-source revenue strategy. And when you look at, for example, the property value of property bill, which then allows the counties to raise revenue. You look at Nairobi, for example, the last time they reviewed that law was in 1986. And that means the money that is being lost, if Nairobi collected a lot of their own source revenue based on the current market rates, they will not even need the shareable revenue. And this goes for Mombasa and these other big cities, Kisumu, Eldoret, and such. So I think we need to, it's time we relooked at our strategies, and let us empower the counties to collect their own revenues, and let us also encourage them to spend at source, so long as we have a mechanism of how that is managed.
Well, interesting right there, especially on spending at the source. Just shifting focus, still with what the CS told the Senate Committee on Budget and Finance, he mentioned that some counties are largely to blame for the unused billions of shillings in state of donor cash lying at the central bank. Perhaps your take on this, because the counties vehemently denied this, mentioning that the money is already allocated to ongoing development projects. Your take, sir?
Yeah, I think the counties are right, because, you know, there's been this blame game where, you know, Treasury says a lot of money is lying in the accounts. I don't think that the way the counties, you know, the pressure that people, counties get, and I've been a governor, and I know the pressure that governors get to get implemented or development as such, you know, what is called development, both physical and even the human resource, human development. The pressure that the counties get, I don't think that there will be a county that would have money lying somewhere in the bank unutilized and yet not be able to access it to utilize the money. So I think that matter also really needs to be demystified so that we know why. We are now about 8 years into devolution. Why would a county, for example, not have capacity to utilize the resources that have been that have been sent to the account? What is the problem? Because, you know, we experienced those challenges when we started as pioneer governors, because then we didn't have the human capital. We were just putting in place structures, and there were all those manner of challenges because the devolution had never been implemented. But 8 years into this, I doubt that there is a county that would not have capacity to spend money credited to the account for whatever project or whatever development project that there is. So I think that is where we need to really find out what is happening, because there seems to be the blame game with no treasury saying, okay, county governments are not able to spend money, and then county saying treasury is not placing money to us. So I think that is where the problem lies, and we must unravel that problem.
Well noted, sir. Let's talk about this blame game and the pressures the counties are facing, some of them being in the form of the pending bills. I know you mentioned it earlier. I know Mr. Yatani did mention and gave a directive to the counties to pay bills totaling 11.5 billion Kenya shillings by June 30th. All this while they're riddled with issues to do with getting their fair share from the national government. Talk to me about this. What do you envision being the solution to pending bills specifically? Because it seems we just didn't devolve functions from the national government. Issues to do with pending bills have also been devolved from the national government, sir.
You know, there are two ways of looking at the pending bills. One of the problems that I know faced counties, and this must also be addressed, is a political problem where we had governors, new governors coming in, like even my own county where I was a governor, where a new governor comes in and he says he doesn't want to pay pending bills, he doesn't want to pay bills that were incurred by his predecessor. Because maybe when those projects are completed, the credit will go to the predecessor. Now, that kind of issue should be tackled, because if you having also served as a permanent secretary in mainstream government, when you are transferred to another ministry, whoever comes just is seamless. You pay the bills, because it's not politics. You pay the bills that you find there, as long as you have verified and established that these are proper bills. But we are talking about the politics here, because governors are elected. So a governor gets there and says he's not going to pay those bills because he does not, he wants to start his own projects where he will pay projects that will give him credit. So again, that is an issue that I think we have even tackled in the Senate to say, when the takeover, how does the new governor take over, and what should he do and what should he not do, so that we avoid these pending bills. And you find bills there and they are verifiable, because I know there was even a team that verified the pending bills to ensure that they are okay, because again, there we had actually pending bills that were suspicious, and therefore the governors who took over were a bit suspicious, like, you know, we may pay and get into trouble with the corruption cases and that kind of thing. But that problem must be sorted out, where whoever takes over and the bill is verified, we should be able to clear the pending bills before you tackle any other development project. It's a big problem. And I know, like I mentioned, we have had suppliers who have suffered because they were perceived to be, they belong to the former regime before the new regime took over. So it's an issue that really must be addressed.
Quite so, and I'm sure many Kenyans are waiting for these issues to be addressed. Sir, let's talk about the reality on the ground. Right now we're talking about roughly 15% to the county governments. There are proposals through the BBI to raise this to 35%, and many might argue that this is a piped dream if the process so far is anything to go by. You yourself mentioned that since the inception of devolution, delay has been synonymous. Well, what's your take on this? Because it feels like it's a reality, but it's slowly slipping from our hands due to how the resources are managed.
That is true, but what I agree with is it's good to be cushioned. You know, it's good to have a law that guides that this is the minimum, so that now when then you're only dealing with maybe the practicalities of having the money going there. But it's good to have a law that guides how much should actually go there, so it's not left to the discretion of whichever government that is in power then to decide how much goes there. And that's why I agree. Because like now we have pushed it to 27% because this year the share of revenue has moved to from 316 to 370. Remember the formula that had a lot of issues in the Senate, and eventually it actually attempted 12 times, but eventually it went through pushing the money to 370. That was a big score. So I agree that whereas we may have challenges in terms of disbursement of the funds at the right time, the revenue collection because of the challenges, because you see that they're also saying maybe, now everybody's saying, that there was this COVID which slowed down the economy, and therefore raising revenue has been a problem. But I think it is important to have a law that guides what goes there, so that what now remains is the practicalities and also the political goodwill to make sure that this money goes there. Because if you leave it at the discretion, somebody can wake up and even say, the counties don't deserve money. And like somebody has said and everybody else keeps saying, the best way to kill devolution is to deny the counties the money, or if you want to kill a dog, you give it a bad name, deny it food, and then you say now this dog must be killed. So that I think that it's good and important to have the law to cushion how much money should go to the county, so that then we are now dealing with the practical aspects of is it going at the right time, or have we gotten to the threshold that the law requires?
Well noted. The law is definitely going to play a key part in this whole squabble. As we finalize, sir, this is not an ideal situation, of course, and we appreciate that it has been touted as less revenue due to the COVID-19 pandemic and all that. But if MIS will be closing, if it's not already closed in the counties, yes, they might be getting their money, but how do counties obtain these funds and still procure medicine, still procure the much-needed necessities for the population with this, quote-unquote, constrained time? As we finalize, perhaps, is this simply a legislative issue, policy issue, or would you term it as goodwill, as priority issues on the National Treasury?
Yeah, I think it's also, it's two levels. I think there's the goodwill. From where I see it, I think there's goodwill. I don't think that there's anybody who doubts that devolution was necessary for this country, that devolution has worked. It has had its own challenges. And I know that even when you look at the trade, the CS Finance, it was a governor like myself. Mm-hmm. So now this day, today I sit in the Senate, he sits in Treasury, and therefore he understands the importance of having resources get to the counties in time. He understands the importance of devolution working, because if you wanted the Kenyans to riot or to protest now, is to try and claw back the achievements of devolution. So I think there is political goodwill. We just need to style up the way we disperse the resources. And I want to appeal to my colleague Yatani, whom we served as governors together, that the governors are looking up to us. Even me, as I sit in the Senate, they are looking up to us as their colleagues who served as governors to ensure that devolution works. So when they look at Yatani, they see Yatani as one of them. When they look at Lusaka in the Senate, they see me as one of them. Therefore, we must make sure that this works out for the best of this country and for them to be able to deliver.
Exactly. So we can all enjoy the fruits of devolution. Many thanks, Kenneth Lusaka, right there, Speaker of the Senate, sparing time to talk about the cash crunch in the counties. Of course, the CS for Treasury giving the assurance that money will be released by the end of this week. Let's see if the quote-unquote goodwill from the National Treasury, as Lusaka put it, will actually be manifested even as we await for that disbursement of roughly 39 to 40 billion Kenya shillings to the counties. We now take a short break on that particular note. When we come back, we'll shift.